Schäfer. Gerald Schäfer is from the Loughborough University in the United Kingdom, where he works as an associate professor. And his talk is about something really interesting. He talks about a quick glance at JPEG images, and he uses the Huffman tables in those JPEG images, and he transforms those Huffman tables to get a much quicker overview when you browse through lots of JPEG images. All right, Gerald.
Do you need to use both microphones, or do you need me to use both of them? Okay. Right. Thanks for the introduction, which gave almost everything away, I'm afraid. So I'll try to keep it short then, so we can make it for lunch. First author, David Edmondson, is one of my PhD students. He's now in his third year of his PhD. And the kind of theme of his, what he's looking at is compressed domain image retrieval, in particular looking at doing that in the JPEG compressed domain. So unlike many of you here, we're not working on videos, we're working on images, simpler maybe. So we know that when we're looking for images, we're trying to retrieve images from large image collections. That's not that simple. There's been a lot of work on content-based methods for retrieving images. Quite often that's performed in this query by example or following this query by example paradigm. We're giving a query image and then we're retrieving visually similar images from the data set. If you're trying to retrieve, perform content-based retrieval from kind of online sharing sites like Flickr and so on, that has got some additional problems because that hasn't got a CBR engine integrated, so we can't actually perform that kind of retrieval there. Now, typical content-based image retrieval, how it usually works is we've got our images, potentially large image collections, so we can extract various features from those images, and then we store those features as indices in our database. Then when we try to perform retrieval, we have, in that query by example fashion again, we've got a query image. For that one, again, we're extracting the same kind of features. And then we can compare those features with all the features from the data set. And then we just rank them based on the established similarity. That gives us then the retrieval results. Now, if we actually don't have, or if we can't perform that kind of retrieval, for example, if we don't have actually a database of stored features, or if we can't access that in such a way, for example, if you want to perform content-based retrieval on Flickr. So we can't do that. If we still want to do it, essentially it means we have to download the images and perform feature extraction, feature calculation on the fly. We do that, of course, then both for the query images and also for all the images from the data set that we want to consider. And then we perform again the computation of the similarity and the ranking and so on. So this is what we call here online image retrieval. This is what we're trying to address here. Because feature extraction, of course, is computationally, or can be at least computationally, quite expensive. And therefore, if you try to perform it in this online fashion, it might take, it will take quite some time. At the same time, images are typically compressed, because we need to still save in terms of disk space, bandwidth, resources, and so on. They're typically compressed using lossy compression techniques, and the most common one here is, of course, JPEG. So most of the images on the web are stored in JPEG format. Now, that again has got certain issues when it comes to retrieval. If we're looking at CBR techniques, they mostly operate actually in the pixel domain, so they work on uncompressed data. So if we try to, again, perform feature extraction on the fly, we actually need to first uncompress the images, then extract the features, and then we've got the features that we want to work with. So there's a computational overhead associated with that. Even if we actually store the features, then again, that's kind of counters the compression as well. So the alternative that we're looking here is actually trying to perform the feature extraction directly in the compressed domain. So that's what we call also midstream content, therefore put less demand on the resources. So here we're looking in particular at JPEG. So I guess most people are familiar with JPEG. So JPEG is, of course, a lossy compression technique. It's based on the discrete cosine transform. how it essentially proceeds is, so first of all, we switch into different color space, usually YCPCR color space. Then we split the color information according to the channels. We process the image block by block, so it's divided into 8x8 sub-blocks. And then on each of those 8x8 sub-blocks, we are applying the discrete cosine transform. So that gives us a frequency representation. And then we perform essentially quantization, which allows us to discard higher frequency information, which is visually not that important. So we can store that in a kind of a more crude way and keep the, or put more focus on the low frequency information, which is more important here. Then that information is then run length coded, differentially coded, and Huffman coded. That's to maximize the effectiveness of the compression technique. And then we've got essentially we've got our JPEG image. So these again has got all these various operations here. So then at the end we've got a JPEG image, and then the decoding is, well, it's the inverse basically of the various stages. Now if you try to perform compressed domain retrieval in the JPEG JPEG domain, that's typically being based on DC coefficients. The idea is that we don't want to have to perform the inverse DCT, which is the most expensive operation. So we try to extract features directly from the DC coefficients, and from DCT coefficients, I should say. So both the DC and the AC terms that we can get. So if we perform retrieval in the pixel domain, we would need to essentially undo all these compression stages, arrive at the uncompressed image again, extract the features from there. If we try to perform compressed domain retrieval based on the DCT data, that means we're essentially somewhere half in between. That's where we're intercepting the data, and that's where we're what we're using for extracting the features. Now, various things that we can do there. One of the first approaches was by Schneier and Abdelmotaleb. So they essentially define some windows in the image, define like extract based on the DCT terms in there, essentially a binary vector, which is then used as the image feature. And then we can use Hamming distances for making comparison between images. A couple of other techniques, Lee and Guan, so they use a couple of AC coefficients, basically storing statistical information about these and using those as a feature. We've done some work in that area some time ago as well, where we're deriving essentially a color histogram from the DC term. So from each DC term basically captures the average of that 8x8 block. And we also add some kind of texture information, again, based on the DC terms, but based on the DC term of the luminance channel, where we're then using an LPP, local binary pattern, texture descriptor. The color histogram idea was also done by other people. Jiang, that was when he was at a group at Glamorgan. So they also perform JPEG retrieval based on color histograms. They do other stuff as well, where they extract mean and variance information from the DC and from the AC terms. It's also possible to derive kind of an equivalent of the MPEG-7 edge histogram descriptor from the AC coefficients. So we can see each block basically, whether there's an edge, whether it's horizontal, vertical, plus or minus 45 degree, and then again build a histogram of that. Another one is by Lu and colleagues, essentially a combination of different methods where on the one hand, they are storing, again, a color histogram, but they also have got kind of edge and texture information, which they extract from the other coefficients. More recently, we've done some further work in that area where we are looking, well, initially we're looking again, we're just looking at the DC terms here. So each DC term, again, defines the average color or average intensity of an 8x8 block. The way that they're coded in JPEG, they're differentially coded, so that means the difference from one DC term to the next one, the one in the next block. So that difference data that is actually being stored is actually visually meaningful as well. It gives us some information about image gradient, gives also information about kind of uniform areas. If you've got zero differences, that means there's a large uniform area there. So we're actually using that DC difference data directly, building again histograms from that. That can also be combined with color histograms to improve the kind of retrieval performance. So here an example of that, we're actually showing these DC histogram terms for two pairs of images. Clearly there are visual similarities between those two images each. And we can see that that is reflected in those histograms that we can extract there. What is interesting, since we're actually retrieving here the data from the DC difference data, we actually look again at this kind of diagram. So we are capturing the data stream even a little bit earlier, because up here rather than there, we were getting the DCT data. So again, making it slightly more efficient. Still, for that kind of online retrieval that we want to perform here, that's not sufficient. So we want to something which is even faster than that. And for that, we're looking in more detail at kind of last stage of JPEG compression, namely how entropy coding is applied here, in particular Huffman coding is applied here. So again, it's based looking here only at the DC terms again. So those are, as I've mentioned before, differentially coded, and then those differences are Huffman coded. Now, before those DC terms are actually split into two parts, one part is what is called the DC code, which basically tells us how many bits are being used for the other part. Then the other part actually specifies the actual differences. Now, the DC codes, because they are repeating data, so Huffman coding can be applied to that data. Essentially, I've got these, 11 different codes that we can use here. How JPEG images are normally stored, there's a suggested table that is being used in most circumstances, so the same Huffman table being used for all the images. It is also possible to actually optimize it, so essentially to run Huffman coding again on that data and to derive an image-specific, image-adaptive Huffman table. That way we can also actually compress a little bit more and save a little bit more in terms of bandwidth and storage space. And in fact, this kind of optimization is being used, for example, if you upload images to Flickr. It's also being used, for example, on those images from Google Images, those thumbnails. They're also optimized in that fashion as well. And our method here is essentially used and is based on this kind of Huffman table optimization. Again, if I maybe start with an example here, where again, I'm showing you two different pairs of images. And what these ones here are showing, those are the bit lengths for each of those 12 Huffman codes that are being used, the bit length that is being needed to actually store those codes. Now again, just visually looking at that, we see there are similarities between those pairs. And so similar images can lead to similar Huffman tables. And that's really the kind of idea that we are presenting here. So it's very simple what we're doing. As I mentioned, it was almost given away at the very start of, before I even started talking. So we are using these optimized, these tuned Huffman tables essentially as image features. So we can perform image retrieval directly based on these Huffman tables, based on that distribution of those bit lengths. Similar images should have similar Huffman tables. And also, to put it in relation to the kind of early work, because those Huffman tables essentially are kind of an approximation to that DC difference histograms that I was showing before, that we used before. Now, one big advantage of doing that is the Huffman tables are stored in the header of the JPEG files. Since we're using them directly, so they are the features that we're using, we don't need to actually compute them, because that has been done when the file was compressed. So they're in the header. We don't even need to read in the complete file. We just read in the header, and we've got our features, and therefore can use them for image retrieval. Now, how do we use them? How can we derive similarity? Well, we use those bit lengths for each of the codes, and simply we take from the two images or the two Huffman tables that we are getting, and we're just comparing the length of those, the absolute differences of those bit lengths that we've got. Then we integrate luminance information and chrominance information. There are two different Huffman tables that are actually stored in the header, one for luminance, one for chrominance. So we do the same basically for both and combine them. Now, we ran some experiments, of course, on that. We're using the user data set, which is a benchmark data set, not extremely large, but about 1,400 images. But it has got a defined ground truth. So for 260-something images, there are defined query images. And for each query image, correct matching model images are defined. So we can run a, we can see how well different algorithms work. The performance measure that we're using here is the one from the MPEG-7 experiments, so the average normalized match retrieval rate, which basically gives us a number between 0 and 1. The lower, the better. 0 would be perfect. 1 means we're not getting any matches within that window that we are considering here. So these were the results that we're getting. So we could both in terms of the retrieval performance, but also in terms of the time it actually takes to perform an online image retrieval. So that's calculating all the features and performing the similarity computation. Now, we've run that for a couple of pixel domain methods, some of the MPEG-7 methods, and simple color histograms. We've run it for some of the JPEG compressed domain methods, and then, of course, we've got it for the Huffman tables. Now, if you look on the one hand in terms of the retrieval performance, so we see that the kind of compressed domain methods are not so far off the pixel domain methods. So it's interesting that we can use them. We see that when we're looking at the Huffman table method, it does not quite match the performance. So we get somewhat worse results here. On the other hand, when we're looking at the runtime of a query, there's a huge difference here, so we get at least an improvement in terms of a factor of something like 40 or so, even in comparison to the compressed domain methods. We've also tried to do that, actually perform retrieval from Flickr. So there's a sample video where we're selecting, we've uploaded the same data set to Flickr, and we can select one of the query images, and what we're doing here is we're running simultaneously retrieval based on color histograms and based on the Huffman table. So first we're just selecting a query image, and then in parallel we're running these two different methods. So this is ours. We see that here things are filling up much, much faster because we're retrieving images much, much faster. Since we're only reading in a small part of the file header, which directly has got the features that we are using here. And we're also recording, the second thing that you see here, we're also recording the bandwidth that we're actually using for each of those methods. So how much data do we need to download to actually perform that retrieval? So we see relevant images coming up essentially much faster. When we're looking at the overall bandwidth that is required here, for the pixel domain methods, we basically need to download all the images so that we can extract the features. So that takes up quite some data. We also need to do exactly the same thing actually for the kind of normal JPEG domain methods, because again, we first need to have the complete image that we can at least do that partial decompression. So those figures here are the same that we get for the other ones. In Flickr, we can store images, or images are stored at different resolutions. So here we show the results for the kind of the largest and the smallest one here. Ours, since we're just reading data from the header, doesn't really matter which ones of those we are picking. So actually the results that we get here are based on the largest version that is being stored there. We're only reading a fraction of the file. Now, one problem still, of course, remains. If I just go back to that results table that I had here. So the retrieval performance that we're getting does not quite match what we're getting from the other techniques, and that basically led us to the application of using our methods, some kind of a filtering method. So what we're doing here is we run our algorithm first. That gives us reasonably good results, but not the best results. So what we're doing is we're looking at the images that we're getting. We're discarding most of the images, so we're going to keep the top images, top 10, top 20, top 30 images of those that we're retrieving. And then we're processing those images using a second method. So we can pick a compressed domain method. That's what we're doing here in the experiments that are in the paper. So we're using that method by Luli and Burkhardt as the second method. So we discard most of the images. That should get rid of all the irrelevant images, the ones that we don't need. Then we process the remaining ones using a more accurate method. And overall, we should still get a significant speed up. So that is confirmed by the experimental results. So this is, again, on the same data set that we used before. And here we're showing the results based on different filtering settings. So the first line here is where we don't do any filtering at all. So that's the performance that we're getting just from the other technique that we're using afterwards. And then we filter certain percentages of the data set down to the last line gives, well, 100% filtering. That means that's the performance that we're getting just from our method. So obviously we're looking at the results somewhere in between. And usually when we're looking at discarding about 80% of the images, we find that we essentially match the retrieval performance that we're getting from the secondary method that we're employing. But at the same time, we gain a significant speed up, roughly about a factor of 5 overall. And the same thing scales as well. So these were based on that user data set. We've then also merged that data set with the MIR data set, which is 25K images. The results are pretty much the same, at least in relation to each other. So again, when we're looking at about 80% of, but discarding 80% of the images in that initial run based on the Huffman tables, we get pretty much, or almost at least, the same performance in terms of the retrieval accuracy. And again, we get roughly that speed of roughly 1 to 5. So that allows us to do faster retrieval. Just one visual example that we're getting of this. So here we ran one particular query of the data set on that extended, so user and MR data set. So the one, that image up there is the query image. And then I'm showing you 4 different sets of results. So this one here is what we're getting from the compressed domain method by Lu and colleagues. And you can see that we get like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 matches in that top 10. This is what we're getting if we just run things based on the Huffman tables. So we only get 2 of the correct images in the top 10 here. So that's why we're using it as a filtering stage rather than on its own. If we filter, again, those 80%, so that seems to be a good setting. So we get 2, 4, 6. We get almost the same performance that we get from the secondary method here. If you want to do it faster still, we can use like 95% filtering. We get slightly worse results in that case. But then again, the speed up is about 1 to 10 or so. So to conclude, we're using tuned JPEG Huffman tables for image retrieval. So they are stored directly in the JPEG header that allows us to perform quite fast retrieval here, somewhat lower in terms of retrieval accuracy. So for that reason, we then employ it in a filtering stage where we first run our method to discard usually about 80% of the images. The remaining 20% we then run with a secondary method, and overall you get a speed up about 1 to 5, but we match the retrieval performance of that other method that we're choosing. Yeah, that's from my side, so okay. Thank you.
I think we have a few minutes for questions. Yes.
Thanks for the talk. Do you think it would be interesting to investigate whether a different distance measure would make any difference in the performance?
We have tried another one before as well, where we were actually looking at kind of rankings of the length. And indeed, the one that we're presenting here is actually the one that gave better performance. But as always, there are more possibilities, of course, yeah.
let me ask a question myself. Sure. Can you use your method for different sizes of fire extinguishers? So you have a queer image that shows a big fire extinguisher. You have a small fire extinguisher in your collection. Would you find a small one?
That will cause a certain problem because the differences will be somewhat different.
You get different Huffman tables for the two.
Yeah, so the Huffman table will be different, yeah. There are still some issues that we are looking at in here in terms of robustness. So image size is one of them, yeah. I mean, the data set that we employed, they are all fairly similar in terms of the image size. So image size is one factor that will have an influence. Another one is also the image quality, because in JPEG we can actually set a quality setting, and that again will have a direct influence on the Huffman tables as well. So the results that I was presenting here, they're all based on where images are roughly quantized to the same level here. So that's one of the things that David is still looking at the moment. Yeah.
Have you tried this method on videos or?
No, we're not. As I mentioned, we're not doing videos.
But do you have any idea on how it could work, or like?
I don't know enough about video coding, so I'm not sure. But there's in the motion JPEG, there must be a Huffman table as well, I guess. So yeah. On the
All right. I see no other questions. So thanks again very much, Gerald.
Thank you.
And time for us.